An artist's paintbrush can have synthetic bristles or natural ones made of animal hair. Which type to use is really a matter of the artist's preference. However, painters often tend to use a natural brush for watercolours, a synthetic brush for acrylics, and either type for oil paints. These natural hair paintbrushes are made of red sable, the tail hair from a species of weasel. Red sable is renowned for its softness and for spreading paint thinly and evenly. The process begins with the initial steps of making the head of the paintbrush. First, a bundle of red sable hair is unrolled and straightened. Then enough hairs for the brush of the desired size are separated. These are then inserted into a ferrule made of nickel-plated brass. How the hairs fit in the ferrule is tested. If the fit is too tight, some hairs are removed. Too loose, hairs are added. Brushes of different shapes require different tensions. Then, taking a brass mold for the size of brush that's being made, the hairs are inserted all the way into its cavity. The hair's roots are then tied together with string. The brush head is then inserted back into the ferrule, and the string is removed. Next, using a template, the length out of the brush is adjusted. Length out is how far the hairs protrude from the end of the ferrule. After removing any stray hairs, the end of the ferrule is set against the edge of a 22mm template. The hairs are then either pulled out or pushed in until their tips align with the other edge of the template. The assembled brush head is then placed in a rack for the next stage. Here a syringe is filled with epoxy glue, which is then used to fill the ferrule with enough glue to submerge the hairs. Next, after the glue has been left to dry overnight, the brush head is dabbed against a strip of sticky tape to remove any short or loose hairs that haven't adhered. The brush head is then dipped into a solution of starch and water, which is worked into all the hairs by massaging the head on a towel. The starch allows the hairs to be trained into a permanent shape. To form its pointed shape, the head is rotated, then smoothed by hand. The starch dries overnight, locking in the shape. To make the paintbrush handle, birch dowels are slotted into a pegboard. The board is mounted upside down on a dipping machine, and then the dowels are submerged into black lacquer paint. Once dry, a day later, a second dip, this time partially into silver paint. The dipping machine has been adjusted to dip to the required depth. After another day of drying, a third dip, this time partially back into black paint, creating a black handle with a silver stripe. After the final coat has dried, a pad printer stamps key information onto the handle in quick-drying silver ink. One stamp adds the brush hair material used, the size of the brush, the series number, as well as the manufacturer's name. Next, the brush head is glued onto the handle. The brush is set aside for a couple of hours until the glue partially dries to a tacky state. This is because the next stage, crimping, would crack fully dried hardened glue. The ferrule is then inserted into a crimping machine that's been fitted with a die that's the correct diameter for this brush. The machine crimps the ferrule, so it's now permanently attached to the handle. And once the glue hardens, the paintbrush is ready to paint 1,000 words. The first sconces were candle holders attached to the wall by extending brackets to keep the flame a safe distance away. With the invention of electricity, sconces could be mounted flush to walls. This opened up new design possibilities, among them, art glass wall sconces. At this factory, every sconce is made by hand. The process starts with scrap glass from a window manufacturer. The glass is measured and scored with a cutting wheel. Using special pliers, pressure is applied to fracture the glass along the score line. The break is then completed by hand. Two pieces of glass have been prepared. A larger piece has been set aside, while the small piece is taped over a piece of artwork. Using liquefied dark enamel, lines are traced on the glass, creating thick lines that mimic the appearance of lead veins in stained glass. Once the lines are dry, designated colours are painted within them. Each area on the sketch has a letter that corresponds to a specific colour of enamel. The painted pane is then centred onto the clear, larger piece. It's designed to frame the artwork and make it more prominent. The two pieces are then placed into an electrically fired kiln. Here the glass will be gradually heated to 782 degrees Celsius and then cooled over a period of 10 hours. This prevents fracturing as the heat fuses the two panes together and bakes the artwork into the glass. The baking also deepens the enamel colours. Next, it's onto the housing. First, clay is blended to a pudding-like consistency. This is then poured into moulds for the sconce's casing. The clay begins to dry and harden along the inside walls of the mould. Any liquid clay remaining is poured out. Once it's a putty-like consistency, the excess at the top is removed. The mould is set on its side and opened to reveal the newly formed sconce casing. It's then left to cure overnight. The next day, the casing is still soft but can withstand sanding. The rim is shaped and the outside is smoothed. Next is to create the opening for the glass pane. First, lines are scored into the still fragile clay, which are deepened until the excess can be easily removed. Next, a profile is chiseled along the edges that will eventually frame the art glass pane. Holes are then cut into the rear, one for the light socket and the other to mount the fixture to an electrical junction box. The clay casing now spends 8 hours in a kiln, exposed to a temperature of over 1,000 degrees Celsius. This transforms the clay into ceramic. Next, the outside of the ceramic is brushed with a coloured glaze. The inside is left white to better reflect the light. The casing is then baked in another kiln for 6 hours to fuse the glaze to it. The final finish is glossy and the colour is intrinsic to the ceramic. Next, the light socket is fitted through one of the holes in the casing, with the wires being pulled through the back. A brass washer is then threaded over the wires, followed by a second washer that's connected to an earth wire. The washers and light socket fitting are secured into position with a nut. After a bulb has been screwed into the socket, the casing is ready for the art glass pane. First, adhesive is gunned down either side of the pane. The pane is then placed into the ceramic frame of the sconce window and set into position. Pegs are used to hold the pane in place while the adhesive cures overnight. The next day, the art glass sconce is ready to light up your life.